tiny lemmings and hardy caribou inhabit the Arctic wasteland. An Arctic hare makes the most of the brief summer months, while musk oxen do battle over a female. And as the land warms to the midnight sun, the landscape is transformed by a carpet of flowers in the kingdom of the ice bear, tomorrow at 7:15, here on 2. Well, back to this evening now, and in 50 minutes, A Mass for Man, choreographed specially for television by Robert Cohen. It's danced by the London Contemporary Dance Theatre to a new setting of The Mass by Geoffrey Bergen. First, Russell Davis presents Saturday Review.
Saturday Review this week, traditional arts follow technology into the Japanese export drive. Thunderbirds are go. Where have they been? Scratch video. Is it art? Is it legal? Is it worth the trouble?
And people will see who is at fault.
We'll be visiting a Yorkshire mining village to meet its writer in residence, and I'll be joined in discussion of the scratch video issue by Anna Coote, Christopher Dunkley and Michael Flint. First, I'll look at who's been buying and who's selling this week. It was an important week for the novelist John Brain. He put up for auction the diaries he's been writing for more than 30 years, 130 assorted notebooks for which he's sought £25,000, or roughly £1.50 a page.
I want to sell them for a very simple reason. To at least have the down payment on a property of my own in Hampstead. So I'm going to need quite a lot just for the down payment. I may as well pay mortgage is pay rent. At present, I'm living in a rented property, and although it's very pleasant indeed, and I like it very much here, it's not the same thing as owning one's own. If I don't sell them, too bad. I shall survive.
Lot 24 now, the Brain Diaries. £5,000 to start it. £5,000 a bid, £5,000, £6,000, £7,000, £8,000, £9,000, £10,000, £11,000, £12,000, £13,000, £14,000, £15,000. At £15,000 now, bids on my left at £15,000. Any more? £15,000.
Sadly, the reserve price was £25,000, so the diaries did not change hands, and John Brain will not be moving house for the time being. The setback left him undaunted.
But I was prepared for these manuscripts not to sell, and I was prepared. So now, I can't be disappointed, and tomorrow's another day.
The Virgin organisation is keeping up its reputation for enterprise with some new animated graphic advertisements, commissioned from a group called the Design Clinic in conjunction with a new group of animators called iWorks. Piece. One of our biggest national earners, and thank goodness for him, is Shakespeare. His reputation was not notably boosted by Gary Taylor's recent discovery of a new Shakespeare poem, in which a sadly besotted bard, surely not the bard, appears to be describing Miss World.
No mishap, no scape, inferior to nature's perfection. No blot, no spot. Line, darling?
She's beauty's queen in election.
Ah, yes. She's beauty's queen in election. Was there something about a fee, Russell?
You concentrate on your knighthood. Those who prefer Shakespeare on undisputed top form will prefer to visit the enlightened Almeida Theatre in Islington, where the Kick Theatre Company are doing King Lear. Fringe productions of Shakespeare are normally greeted with a terrible weariness by mainstream critics, but this one has pleased them mightily, in spite of a set consisting of three stepladders and a storm scene that involves the cast in dipping their heads in buckets of water to simulate a cloudburst. As you'll see, the whole style takes a bit of getting used to. Robert Demiger as Lear, for example, is hardly old enough to have grown-up daughters. Yet Michael Ratcliffe of The Observer was inspired to comment, "More productions like this and the walls of the RSC will be brought tumbling down."
Speak.
Nothing, my lord.
Nothing?
Nothing.
Nothing will come of nothing. Speak again.
Unhappy that I am, I cannot heave my heart into my mouth. I love your majesty according to my bond, no more nor less.
How? How, Cordelia? Mend your speech a little, lest you may mar your fortunes.
Good my lord! You have begot me, bred me, loved me. I return those duties back as our right fit, obey you, love you, and most honour you. Why have my sisters husbands if they say they love you all? Happily, when I shall wed that lord whose hand must take my plight, shall carry half my love with him. Half my care and duty. Sure, I shall never marry like my sisters to love my father all.
But goes thy heart with this?
Aye, my good lord.
So young and so untender.
So young, my lord, and true.
Let it be so. Thy truth, then, be thy dower. For by the sacred radiance of the sun, the mysteries of Hecate and the night, by all the operation of the orbs from whom we do exist and cease to be, here I disclaim all my paternal care for propinquity and property of blood, and as a stranger to my heart and me, hold thee from this forever. The barbarous Scythian, or he that makes his generation messes to gorge his appetite, shall to my bosom be as well-neighbored, pitied and relieved, as thou my sometime daughter.
Being a writer in residence is traditionally thought of as a bit of a doddle. You sit in a university or library, gently encouraging, or if you really must, discouraging, the efforts at verse and prose that are brought to you by shining-eyed students or old ladies in giveaway hats. But there's another way of doing it. South Yorkshire Library Service have had the idea of sending the playwright Jane Thornton, whose recent play Amid the Standing Corn featured an entire Barnsley mining community played by four actresses, into another such community, a village this time, with a view to producing not a dry oral history such as might be lost in a library forever, but a book evaluating the visible ways in which the recent strike changed the lives of the women attached to the miners' wives support group. The writer Barbara Machin, who was a writer in residence in Ipswich recently, so knows all the perils of this odd position, examines how Jane Thornton was received by the women of Askern.
To almost anybody in Askern, and they will tell you proudly that it was the third most solid pit in South Yorkshire during the recent miners' strike. They will probably also try to tell you stories about the strike, about the picket lines, about the women's support group and the soup kitchen they ran. Not since the war has a community had so much to talk about, and Askern is a very talkative town.
Have we got any socks,
I am getting treatment tonight.
A pie and mushy peas supper run by the Askern Women's Support Group. is a strange place to find a professional writer. But Jane Thornton has been sponsored to live with the women of Askham for a month, to share in their activities, and to become almost invisible. This has given her the unique opportunity to piece together impressions for her book about the women, from thousands of individual stories and individual voices.
She says, I get my degree, and I say, I don't know whether she said end of this month or beginning of December.
Do you think it's changed your life at all, the strike?
Yeah, it has.
In what way?
In a way. Well, I've realised now, before I wasn't really...
Yeah, there's obviously just loads and loads of information. I mean, I've almost got too much. It seems I can go and knock on anybody's door and they let me in and give me a cup of tea and then they just talk.
Well, then when them horses come charging out of that side street, I was frightened.
Did you run?
No, because we had went up a couple of lampposts.
The area in which they live is where their lives are very small in some ways. A lot of them have never been out of this country, or some of them have never been to Leeds or Wakefield. And so for them to go down to London, for one thing, is a big thing. For them to be involved with hundreds of people marching is another big thing. And for them, you know, for them to have to run away from charging horses is like a tremendous thing in their lives. It's, you know, the sort of emotions that they've never experienced before. So I'm dealing with those sort of things and how it felt and what it meant to them rather than the politics of the situation.
The police just was grabbing you by the arms and literally throwing you over the road. And, I mean, it was terrible. I mean, the inspector said, you don't treat these like women, you treat these like the men, you're kicking your neck. And that is honestly what they said. And I was that mad, there were a yellow car there, and I thought, I shouldn't do this, but I'm going to, and I kicked it. And I got arrested. I mean, we were all just miners' wives. We'd never been in trouble, none of us. And, I mean, they were clever with us. Yes, some weren't too bad, but some were really clever with us, you know. When we refused to have his photos taken and his fingerprints, it was right back to yourself. I had sandals on, I had to take my sandals off in case I hurt myself on the sandals, and it was a stone floor. I mean, it was really cold. Take his jewellery off. And I refused to take my rings off because I said they didn't come off. He said, well, you take your watch off because mine comes off. I've got one of those. He says, and I take mine off every night. And I just said, oh, do you really?
To them, it was like, I think it seemed like it was something out of a film. You know, it's the sort of thing that you see on television, but it doesn't ever happen to you. And I think at the time that they could hardly believe that they were there, and so they weren't necessarily frightened. And they did fight a lot of the things. They wouldn't give their names, and they wouldn't give details of where they lived. And they were very brave. But I think afterwards, the experience really did shake them up a lot.
Jane's role as a writer in residence was not only to reflect the disturbing detail of the strike, but also to capture some sense of the character and humour of the women involved.
They make a joke out of me, actually, walking around with a tape recorder and scribbling bits all the time, and then they're always covering their mouths up and saying, don't speak when she's here, because she'll write it all down. And so there's lots of them, but the most recent, really, is when they were preparing for the pie and pea supper, and they were full of jokes, especially when they all get together. And once somebody said, oh, we ought to go into business making pies because we could overthrow Mr. Kipling, so, which I thought was quite a nice idea. And then somebody said, you can stop making the tops now because we've got too many bottoms. And then somebody actually put their hands in the flour and put two hand marks on somebody's bottom. So they were walking around all night with these two big white hands on them. And I thought, that's a nice scene for a play. It's very, very visually interesting and quite funny, and I quite like that.
You know, he seemed to go on and on and on. All we seem to have talked about now for 18 months is the strike and what we did and what the men didn't. I was sat facing Jane across my kitchen table, and she'd got the tape on it in the middle, and she said, I'm just nipping to the loo, don't stop talking, I'll leave the tape running. So I put my hand over what I thought was the mic on the tape recorder, and I said to Diane, God, Di, she's come here to write a book about us. I said, and I feel as though I'm boring arse off her. And when I looked at Di, she was rolling, laughing. I said, what's the matter, what's the matter? And she said, well, that's not Mike, that's Mike round there.
And so on one of my tapes, I've got this little sentence, which they won't let her live down now, and they're saying, you must put that in the book, you must put it in the book. And she was acutely embarrassed that she said it.
We all do tend to, well, I did before the strike, tend to believe everything we see and everything we read, because we're being told that's how it is. Then we accept it. But since the strike, I know now that you've got to look deeper into issues, that, you know, it's not just, you don't take everything at face value. And I just hope that Jane puts our side of the story now fairly, and that people will see that women's groups were an asset to the strike. You know, that they weren't on the make. They really cared about helping people. And if Jane can get that across to the people of this village, well, and people outside the village, that'll really please me. I just hope that Jane's enjoyed being with us, that's all.
A year of outstanding large exhibitions is closing with yet another. Toki, Tradition in Japan Today, which runs till late January in the Barbican. It's the result of a collaboration between the Barbican authorities, the Japan Foundation, and two corporate sponsors from Japan, Wacol and Kyocera. And what it celebrates is the continuity of Japanese art and culture, those elements of traditional and symbolic folk art which have survived unimpaired into the age of triumphant Japanese technology. Among the elaborate toys and puppets on display, there are some that have never been taken beyond the borders of Japan before. For Saturday Review, the exhibition was visited by someone who's had almost the opposite experience. Kazuo Ishiguro, the writer, best known for his book A Pale View of Hills, who was born in Japan but came to Britain as a young child. What did Toki Tradition in Japan Today tell him about the native country to which he has never returned?
I grew up in a Japanese family, albeit an exiled one, and I don't like to think I'm so remote from Japanese values. But things like the tea ceremony, that strange ritual which the West likes to believe epitomizes Japanese culture, has always left me baffled. Here at the Barbican, I had a unique opportunity to quiz a genuine master of tea, who just happens to be English.
I think the thing is that the four principles of tea ceremony, of course, are harmony and respect and tranquility and purity. Now, these are universal feelings. These are not particularly Japanese. But one of my students, for example, says to me that he drives his car much more carefully when he leaves his tea ceremony lesson. It lasts him as far as Clapham Junction at the moment. He hopes eventually going to get him home. So there's a feeling certainly of tranquility. There's a feeling of being in harmony with yourself. But I think overall the tea ceremony can give Western people, as it does Japanese people, a tangible form to express the spiritual side of yourself within this compass of harmony and respect and tranquility and purity. Because all facets of human life are involved in the tea ceremony.
Nihonga, I know, means Japanese art. But the term is more specific than that here, isn't it? Nihonga painting.
Nihonga really means Japanese style painting as opposed to Chinese style painting or Western style painting. In the 19th century, when the borders were opened, various Western influences came in, and something like perspective, for instance, which was unknown to the Japanese, was introduced, and that idea became assimilated by the Japanese, as had previously certain painting styles from China. And an amalgam, really, would describe what Nihonga painting is. There are artists operating today who will be painting in a much more Western-influenced manner. Nihonga is just a particular style of painting that the Japanese use today. The technique that is used is extremely traditional. The paint is made from rock crystal, the original elements, and is ground down extremely finely, and then is built up into a pigment through, or into a paint through the addition of resin, gums, and so on. So the whole technique itself, the process of painting, is based on traditional techniques. I think in this country we tend to imagine the Japanese to be highly automaton, highly modern, high-tech or whatever. And I think it is misleading if we adhere to that misconception.
Shodo is the old, revered art of calligraphy. It's the most severe of art forms and requires real nerve. There's nowhere for the artist to hide. He must express himself in a single moment. There's no retouching the stroke or deliberating once the action has begun. If I'd grown up in Japan, I'm sure I'd have become enticed by Shodo. As it is, the closest I come to the Shodo experience is a terrifying moment before I sign for a credit card purchase, when it occurs to me my signature may not come out right. These are karakuri ningyo, brought here by the Japan Foundation. Ningyo means doll or puppet. Karakuri implies that these are trick puppets, and so they are. They're actually manipulated by hidden men with elaborately concealed strings and pulleys. But these puppets go to great lengths to give the illusion they are robots worked by some clever mechanism. Ningyo, like these, some of which can be as much as 5 feet tall, are brought out once a year all around Japan to be paraded on gigantic chariots at Shinto festivals. The photographs of Tadanori Saito capture images of a Japan which has little relation to tea houses and quiet rock gardens. I came to them with some relief, an oasis of contemporary concern and realism. Crowding, conformity, a numbness of spirit feature in his scenes of Tokyo life. His is a lonely, almost peripheral voice in an exhibition heavily weighted towards the ritualistic, the esoteric, the most self-consciously traditional in Japanese culture.
A lot of this exhibition is great fun, sometimes quite spectacular. But I rather doubt if anyone's going to leave it feeling any more familiar with Japanese values or the way Japanese people feel and think. In fact, if anything, an exhibition like this, enjoyable though it is likely to reinforce the idea that Japanese culture is fascinating precisely because it is alien, exotic, and impenetrable.
Yes, be prepared for a staggering difference of mood between the photographs and the paintings in that exhibition. A week ago in the London Film Festival, an evening of scratch videos was shown. Scratch video is a controversial new form which involves the makers in taking TV or tape images from wherever they may find them. In fact, pilfering images, as the NFT booklet frankly puts it, and knitting them together, often with repeat edits, slow motion sequences and other subversive effects, to make a comment on some cultural issue or perhaps on the pilfered images themselves. The influence of the pop video industry is obvious here, but the scratch video people are generally more highly politicized than that, and their work, whatever the legal problems that bedevil it, does at least represent one way of fighting back against the tide of images with which we normally allow ourselves to be swamped. To give you an idea of what scratch video involves, we let loose a contingent from Gorilla Tapes in the BBC's own archive. We managed to limit the damage to this.
We believe that Britain will be the next country to give fascism a chance.
Yes, Prime Minister.
Look, we have taken from Africa, regardless of the perception of the rest of the world. That is so, and people will see who is at fault.
She can have it.
She can have it.
This is Michael Burke for the 9 o'clock news in Johannesburg, South Africa.
I mean, what sort of a life is he going to lead in South Africa with your apartheid, eh?
We have to be careful. This is an emergency area, and should there be any trouble, the camera crew is now required by law to leave the area immediately, and I must turn myself over to the police.
Nice, you could end up in a bloody nick, you could.
Foreign Minister Pick Boota.
Yeah, his unfortunate name, isn't it?
It was not television, it was tunnel vision.
That's good to have a laugh. Well, I mean, you've got to laugh these black days, isn't it? What with, you know, who? Down the road there. No names, no patch, do
I? I stated in Parliament that I believe in press freedom, believe in press freedom, believe in press freedom, believe in press freedom, press freedom, freedom.
Have you heard it on the news about this fascist group thing? Evil men with racist views spreading all across the land. Don't just sit there on your ass and look that funky chain dance. Brothers, sisters, shoot your best. We don't need this fascist group thing. Brothers, sisters, we don't need that fascist group thing. Brothers, sisters, we don't need that fascist group thing. History will repeat itself. Crisis point, we're near the hour. Counterforce will do no good. Hot US, I feel your power. Hitler proves that funky stuff. It's not for you and me, girl.
No, 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 no.
Europe's an unhappy land. They've had their fascist group thing.
Brothers, sisters, we don't need that fascist group thing. Brothers, sisters, we don't need that fascist group thing.
Hello?
Exercise the right to dream.
I have a dream. The promised land. I may not get there with you, but I want you to know tonight that we as a people will get to the promised land. I've seen the promised land.
On the one hand, you've got people producing lots and lots of technology and hardware that makes it ever easier to produce and to reproduce images on magnetic tape. And all this stuff is coming into us from Japan all the time, more and more and more of it, and we're going to have satellite and cable, and then there's cassette already in this country with a lot of people owning video cassette recorders. So you've got, on the one hand, all these different ways of disseminating and producing images. Different pathways are being created from the old pathways. On the other hand, what you've got is the people that are actually producing those images in the first place. The people that hold the copyright on them, the software, what you could call the software producers, they are finding it increasingly difficult to actually keep control of the work that they produce and of the images that they produce, simply because there are so many new pathways being created for disseminating them, changing them, playing with them, and so on. So there's a gap that's opened up between the hardware producers and the software producers, and in some ways Scratch goes straight into that gap and says, let's take some images from here, let's play with them, and let's distribute them in our own ways.
Yeah. As a video artist, you can't help but be under the pressure of the mass of TV, and certainly pop videos in the last 10 years have really changed the audience, because whereas 10 years ago people might wonder, what's the meaning of that shot? Why is that shot there? Today, if it looks nice, that's good enough. And so things, it's really the demise of narrative. And if you're a video artist, it's, in a way, it's never been a better time to be one.
Who is it?
How you doing? For lunch, for lunch, for lunch.
I'm never referential. I'm never referential, because in a way you have to understand that it's completely on the outskirts. It doesn't get shown on television very much. So there's no sense in which I have to worry about who actually made it or asking permission to do anything. In the same way that, you know, Ferdinand Leger wouldn't ask the company if he could use a bus ticket in one of his collages. It just doesn't come into it for me. And in many ways, I like doing what I'm doing because it puts pressure on the whole notion of people owning imagery.
We've had a lot of difficulties getting hold of images legally to use in our work. And one of those difficulties has been not necessarily a financial one, though that is true. You have to pay a lot of money to buy images. But even when we've had the money available, which we have done on some productions, we've found that people have been extremely nervous to let it go. Even though our very naive understanding when we started out was simply, oh, well, if you've got the money to pay the copyright clearance, you can buy the image and you can use it. But it doesn't work that way. It doesn't work that way at all.
Our thanks to those in the BBC's news and light entertainment departments who gave us permission to use the material in that way. Here to discuss what the whole scratch phenomenon portends in terms of art and commerce are Anna Coote, a producer of Diverse Reports, Christopher Dunkley, TV critic of the Financial Times and author of the recent Penguin special Television Today and Tomorrow, and Michael Flint, solicitor and author of User's Guide to Copyright. Chris, scratch video is the sort of thing TV technicians have been doing for years to amuse themselves and their colleagues. Now it's being put forward as a sort of art form. How close does it come to being one, do you think?
I think it's very difficult to try and decide whether it's an art form. I suspect perhaps it's not, but I'm not sure that it matters whether or not it is. I see it, I suppose, more in the way that one might see the objet trouvé idea in art, or even the notion of building things up as a collage from found objects to make another statement about previously used images. It seems to me that if you want a parallel, that's the nearest parallel. I think it's quite exciting because I think it's something really, although it comes largely out of rock video, I think, rock videos, it's the first thing that has actually used the medium in a way that I have several times over the last few years wished that it did, and even written pieces saying, why don't they? It actually takes the medium as a kind of an element, like paint almost, to take it and use it in that way, and I think, you know, that's exciting.
Well, it's taking images from where they haven't been taken before. Is there a kind of freedom of information point wrapped up in this, Anna, do you think? Do you think images in general should be freer, available for use?
Yes, the first thing is that if you enjoy watching it, then, and I think most people do, get something out of watching scratch video, then it ought to be available. I cannot see why the material shouldn't be made available, provided it doesn't put the copyright holder out of pocket. So it ought to be available to whoever wants to use it. That seems to make absolute sense. And a change in the copyright law is so overdue. Let's hope that this scratch video phenomenon will build up public pressure for it, because that's what's been lacking up till now. There hasn't really been a strong lobby. So with any luck, the scratch video people will be the people who will make that happen. I hope so. It really is about time.
Well, Michael, how geared up is the law at this moment to deal with this phenomenon?
Well, the real problem, I think, is that the law as it now stands is based on a 1911 law changed in 1956, the subject of a royal report in 1977, a green paper in 1981, hopefully a white paper any day now, due in October, we still don't have it. So, as of now, you say, well, fine, here's a green paper saying let's change the law, bring it up to date. So you turn to the relevant bit and you say, what, in fact, is the government's view on it? And we see that the Whitford Committee, reporting in 77, took exactly the same view as Anna and said that it would not be unfair to allow people to use other works if it didn't unreasonably prejudice the economic interests of the author. However, the government has said in the same document, we don't agree and we are not going to allow people to use bits of film, bits of video, in the same way as they can with literary works and musical works and works of art. I think it's very curious, and it's not well argued, I don't think, in there, that it's only a half paragraph on the whole subject.
I mean, my objection is that in many cases, if what you want to do is, for example, make a programme about television, which has happened in the past, you're put into enormous difficulties. I myself have had that difficulty here in this very organisation, trying to talk about television on television and to illustrate it in the same way that you would illustrate a piece of poetry, if you were writing a piece of criticism about poetry, or a piece of prose, and you simply can't do it if the person who owns that image says you can't. Mm. Which means, in a way, that you simply can't do it on television, which is absurd, because that's where it should be done.
Mm. It undermines the whole idea of, about criticism. You can't criticise television on television. So I've been involved in producing television programmes where we've looked at the way that the BBC and ITN have made their news programmes, and we have tried to reproduce bits of the news programmes so that we can criticise them. Now, this works fine, provided they must know the exact context. We have to get their permission. They've got to know the context, and we've got to pay for it. If they don't like what they think we're going to say about them, then they simply say, you can't use it. So that means you can't criticise them. I mean, the situation is really absurd.
So all you were really after in that case was a transfer into TV terms of the situation that applies with books?
As a matter of course, yes. It doesn't. There's no question that we're going to be making a huge amount of money out of Alistair Burnett or whoever it might be by doing this. We just want to have the right, which ought to be a basic right, to say we think what he's done deserves to be criticised, or whoever else it might be.
Do you think that perhaps the reason why the legislation is in the form it's in and why the judges have refused to take a different view is because with television, you've only got four channels now, you've only had three until recently, it's transitory, it's off and on, whereas in literary criticism, there are many magazines, many newspapers, many places in which contrary views to a bad review can be seen. It's lying around the house, you can access it. And there is, I think, a case that there is some difference between criticism on television on the one hand and literary criticism on the other.
But I can't see why the transience of broadcast television should mean that it's less reasonable for one to want to criticise it.
I think I can see why. I think that actually the word used there as a verb, access, is what matters. Mm. It is a bit difficult because up until very recently, most people couldn't actually record what you or I were going to say about them on television. If we were doing a programme saying such and such a thing is good, is bad, because of this, and then give a series of examples with pictures, almost like a scratch video, there was no way they could keep that and take it out of their pocket and say, look, you did wrong here. Now, actually, they can now do that, because
then there'd be a breach of copyright in doing it.
Well, OK. Yes. Yes. But what I'm saying is you could now have a video cassette recorder, and you can record that programme and say, well, I'm not having that. That's you can, in other words, you can take the cutting out of your pocket. You can take the cassette off the shelf and say, I've got a copy of what you said, and it's wrong at that point there. Now, at that point, it seems to me that the technology is working to everybody's advantage. A, the scratch video boys can do what they want to do, and B, I can keep a copy of it in case I think I want to argue later that they've done it wrong or misrepresented me or whatever. And I would have thought at that stage you've got to begin to talk about changing what are the laws at the moment.
Well, we'll wait for the government white paper with fingers on the pause button. Thank you all very much. 20 years ago, when Steven Spielberg was still in short films, ATV broadcast the first episode of Thunderbirds, a television series without which, arguably, Ronald Reagan's Star Wars program would be unimaginable. It was produced by Gerry Anderson, whose previous successes, Fireball XL5 and Stingray, were merely a prelude to this worldwide success. Only 32 episodes of Thunderbirds were produced, and the revolutionary new puppet filmmaking technique called Super Marionation never did quite replace live actors, as it first threatened to do. At the height of the production boom, Anderson employed over 250 staff at his studios, and many critics hailed him as Britain's Disney. In Mark Urban's film, Saturday Review examines the cult that has grown out of Thunderbirds and talks to some of the stars who have remained silent on this subject, as on many others, for 20 years.
Without a doubt, Thunderbirds changed our lives. It made us household names. It made stars out of us. And for that, we should thank Gerry Anderson, because he came up with the idea of international rescue.
It came to me that a rescue organisation was an ideal format for action, adventure, danger, destruction.
Well, David Holliday, who played Virgil, rang me up and said they were looking for another actor. So I went along, and Sylvia Anderson said, Don't say a word. You're Alan. So I got the part because I looked like a puppet.
We had a screening for Lou Grade. I mean, always when the first film was completed, I would race up to town and sit there shaking in my boots in the dark while he watched the show. And he jumped up and said, fantastic, absolutely fantastic. And a couple of days later, we suddenly started to get a stream of calls from the national press. And the very next day, when all the nationals carried huge stories, you know, like literally the broadsheets carrying double page center spreads and the evening papers carrying half page photographs, that was when it suddenly dawned on me that we had made one hell of an impact.
The technology was very important to the series. It was years ahead of its time. It was even rumored that the U.S. Air Force used to watch the program for ideas.
I think all these machines were things that appealed to me, excited me. I would drive into work and I would see people making a road. And maybe there were four or five machines involved in making the road. And I just simply went through the mental process of thinking, thought process of thinking, what if there was one huge machine where you could literally pour all the raw materials in one end and drive the thing forward very slowly and excavate, lay the foundations, put the top surface on and then paint the marks and bash the cat's eyes in it, wouldn't that be marvellous? I mean, I've always believed that pretty well anything that man wants to do, man can do, given time.
I suppose my contribution, if you like, to Thunderbirds was to sort of humanise it a bit. Jerry was great on the hardware, you know, he would... He would think of these wonderful machines that did everything and etc. And one would put this into terms whereby for an hour or a half hour, however long the episode was, you suspended disbelief that you made the people not see the strings, I guess.
The character of Parker was based on a bloke called Arthur, who worked in a pub in Cookham. Arthur had been a butler in the royal household. Well, Jerry sent me down to the pub to pick up Arthur's mannerisms. Poor old Arthur. Never found out it was based on him.
I mean, as a writer, I didn't think, I'm writing for this wooden object with one expression, because I won't mention names, but you can think of actors too who are equally applied.
You wouldn't believe, Russell, what a cult Thunderbirds has become. Since 1981, the fan club has been holding annual conventions. I understand they even have a national committee that organizes these things.
Okay, Keith, local routes.
I thought maybe I should do another article for the next newsletter.
Yes.
I've already drafted out one, which also includes areas where I think we should have, we need local group coordinators.
Great, yes.
So I've got a whole wad. Of people.
Especially up north. Yes.
Wonderful, yeah. All these, there's none in their area.
Oh, no.
SIG is the official Gerry Anderson fan magazine. We originally had it as Super Marionation is Girl. It covers all of Gerry Anderson's film and television work and currently prints around 3,500 copies per issue. Thunderbirds in particular, I think, has got marvellous qualities to it. It is the only hour-long puppet series which allowed for greater characterisation. It also meant that special effects could be developed quite highly. But it's good versus evil, the good guys coming to rescue people in peril. And of course that's got universal appeal.
It's illogical, but people can make a living impersonating us. The Mime Theatre Project toured the country doing a show about us.
We'll be right back.
I think that one of the reasons so many people remember Thunderbirds was because it always ended up with an incredible cliffhanging rescue. That was very important to Jerry.
That was my end sequence. That was my end visual sequence. Now it was a question of how to arrive at that ending, and I would then go back to the front and pitch the story so that we ended in that way.
We made 32 programs and 2 feature films. By that time, TV 21 and Lady Penelope were the biggest selling comics in the country. A whole toy merchandising industry had sprung up, but then it all stopped.
And I went to see Lou Grade, and I was shocked when he said, I think we ought to make something entirely new. But at that time, I didn't think he is wrong and I'm right. I just assumed that he knew best and accepted it. But of course, in retrospect, it was a very great mistake. I think Thunderbirds could have gone on for years and years if we had a...
Much as I can do to keep my arms still. There they go now. In 3 weeks' time, Saturday Review will be back with our review of the year. The entire output will be sifted by Christopher Ricks, Hermione Lee and A.N. Wilson. Next week we take off to prepare, but I'll be here with Peter Clayton to introduce the opening night of BBC2's Jazz Week. We leave you tonight with another affectionate tribute to Thunderbirds, recorded during the heyday of the series by Peter Cook and Dudley Moore. In all that they've done since, they've never faced an acting challenge like this. Good night.
Five, 4, 3, 2,
come on,
1, the first Thunder Steam car is go!
Activate Thunder Stanger Craft Stark.
Come on up there. Super Thunderstein car has come.
Excellent. My ruse has worked. I can proceed with the destruction of international rescue. Now the Thinger Stupa Thing bar is out of the way.
You mean Super Thunderstein car, Master Braun.
Shut your face, Kraut.
Yes, Master Braun.
Deactivate Central Mystifier.
Yes, Master Braun.
On to Francesco Rosi's Illustrious Corpses. A series of murders appears to be motivated by revenge, but investigations reveal political intrigue.
E lei, Rogas?
Sì, buonasera, dottore.
Cosa vuole dal presidente Ricas?
Voglio avvertirlo del pericolo che corre.
Lei insiste. Insegue sempre il suo pazzo.
Sarà il mio pazzo, i suoi gruppuscoli, ma il presidente verrà ucciso.
Il presidente è ben guardato.
Lo so. Oggi c'era tutto lo Stato Maggiore a guardarlo.
E ho visto anche la sua macchina. Non eravamo da Riques. C'era un ricevimento all'ambasciata portoghese che è lì accanto.
Il suo mestiere, mio caro amico, è diventato ridicolo. Andava bene in tempo di pace, ma oggi siamo in guerra. Rapine, sequestri, uccisioni, sabotaggi, questa è guerra. E come in tempo di guerra, la risposta è decimazione.
Illustrious Corpses, tonight at 10:10, here on BBC Two.